Okay, so now we focus on our issue for the September 2nd to September 9th week of 2017. And the BRICS summit just transpired at Xiamen, China. And the column in the Manila Standard of Mr. Rod Kapunan here, BRICS and the Western Economic Order, prompted us to invite him and focus on this impact of the BRICS on the world order. Do we now have a changing world order from what was dominated by the West to the multipolar new world order? So give us a gist of the points here in your article.
The most important point is that BRICS, led by China and Russia, they are veering away from the traditional approach of using capital to exert political pressure. That's another thing. The members of BRICS, as much as possible, are trying to concentrate on economic development, detached from the political pressure that has been characterized by most financial institutions led by the World Bank, the IMF, and the ADB. First important thing is that before the meeting at Xiamen, there were talks that India might just snub the meeting and that will destroy the expectations of many. Actually, when Prime Minister Narendra Modi decided to attend, actually, that decision was more of his concern to maintain the unity of BRICS. He was more concerned of the economic benefits he will gain by joining the meeting rather than by snubbing the meeting. It is not really that there was a settlement that happened prior to that between China and India on Doklam Pass in Bhutan.
Or the Dolang in Chinese name.
But the important thing is that both sides gave importance to the summit. Because of its financial benefit.
We can say that the BRICS already created one of the major peacemaking event or opportunity. Because the BRICS summit itself forced the two nations to come to some modus vivendi on this matter. And I think that is what the original idea of the BRICS alliance or partnership intended.
This is the important thing is that there is a changing values in any political alliances, in any political blocs. For instance, members of BRICS, they give more importance to the next project they will have to undertake. But look at North Atlantic Treaty Organization. The members are complaining. Although the United States is shouldering 75% of the budget, and other countries are contributing something like 5 or 10%, less than 10%. That budget, actually, it is not enough because they are questioning the fact that NATO is expanding its activities beyond the original border when it was created sometime in 1954.
Yeah, well, the first point that you're making is that the BRICS partnership focuses on the economic development of the countries involved. And number two, one of the effects of this is that the political sanctions, political economic sanctions being imposed becomes less effective because of this.
Oh, by the way, let me explain this. Economic sanction is not part of the weapon, or it's not even mentioned by the members of the Greek that we should do this, impose economic sanction. No.
Yeah,
it is absent.
Precisely.
In the declaration.
Your point is that this is one alliance or partnership that avoids such kinds of sanctions.
Economic sanction is a political weapon rather than an economic weapon, and it is a lose-lose situation to them. It's a lose-lose rather than a win-win situation.
And of course, there are many questions about its impact on the current system. In fact, this headline, BRICS does this multinational trade agreement jeopardize the future prosperity of North American market. So it is
the creation, for instance, if the creation of the of contingent reserve fund is part of that. It simply means that other currencies will be available to states, to countries seeking a loan from the BRIC, the new economic development bank, the new development bank, without having to acquire much dollar
reserve. Because in the past decades, the world and especially the third world countries have experienced financial attacks and financial threats from the dollar countries, from the United States in particular. When a dollar attack is launched, the target countries need to scrounge for dollars and so on. So this reserve fund will support countries that are under financial attack.
The CR, the contingency reserve arrangement, has two important aspects. First, it tries to do away with the system of service fees. You know, you pay banks if you want to obtain dollars. You pay. There's a service fee for that. That is other than the interest fee. Second, the reserve fund offers immediately, it is convertible not only to dollars, to any currency for as long as you are a member of the Greeks. So that is the second advantage. The third advantage is that the interest is very low and it is payable through the new development bank.
Ah, okay. Well, speaking about the new development bank, let's look at some of these headlines from various international news sources. A new BRICS bank plan, $1.5 billion lending for South African projects. And the next one, BRICS bank to finance technological innovation projects. Another one is BRICS bank, the new development bank, NDB, approves $1.4 billion loan for projects in India, China, and Russia. This is from the Hindustan Times, this report. But also, beyond the banking and financial issues, is the role of the dollar in this
much
different
diminished.
It's going to be much diminished. Can you explain that further?
Because, you know, the currency reserve arrangement and the creation of the new development bank, it's the bank of BRIC-owned bank. It simply means that dollar member countries, in fact, any country seeking the financial help of BRIC can do away with the dollar. So you did, unlike
in trade between the BRICS members.
Normally, if you are a member of the IMF, you will only have to deal with dollars, or with the World Bank. If IMF, it's either dollars or the European how do you call it?
The Euro dollar.
But under the BRIC, the new development bank, you can use anything. You can use ruble, you can use gold, you can use yuan or anything, or any kind of the rupee. Because of that, it's the convertibility. But there is the currency reserve arrangement, which is fluctuating. Na hindi ka kakapusin ba? Hindi ka kakapusin pag-uutang, hindi ginigipit. That's what I mean.
Okay, again, some headlines to highlight this. From the BRICS Business Council, for example, non-dollar trading, emerging economies deal a heavy blow to the petrodollar because there is now yuan and ruble
that is what
trade in oil and gas, and same thing with India, Russia is, and India.
If I may add to that, remember that when the United States imposed an economic sanction, particularly to well-to-do Russians by prohibiting them from using their so-called credit cards. Immediately after that, they asked the assistance of China. Because China was the first to introduce its own credit system. Parang tinanong, paano maginawa yun? And then immediately, the Russians introduced their own credit card. Actually, it turned out to be a big blow to Goldman Sachs. Sila na wala ng credit card nila.
So it's happened. Goldman Sachs that suffered,
that suffered
because they lost a market.
And immediately, they began to criticize Obama for that sanction. It backfired. That's the effect.
Yeah, but that's why. That's the point. In sanctions, both sides suffer.
Yeah.
Here's another headline that highlights your point. Moscow and Beijing, this is from Zero Hedge. Moscow and Beijing join forces to bypass U.S. dollar in global markets and shift to gold trade. Yeah. So there is a lot of development.
That's why the price of gold is increasing tremendously, almost every day.
And this next headline is from the Asia Times. And it says, BRICS for gold, a dollar-smashing monetary revolution. This goes on and on. So,
by the way, go ahead. Haven't you noticed Germany withdrew all their gold reserves?
Gold from the
Federal
US
Bank. US Federal Bank. Yeah. It seems you have to interpret that. It means a lot.
Well, we read that news item in our previous week's episode, I think. And so that really should raise the alarm for other countries and for other people of the German preparation for possible turmoil in the dollar markets.
In one word, it is simply means increasing lack of confidence in the US dollar.
Yeah. And about sanctions, which is one of your key ideas, although I think you'll be writing more about it in the future, the U.S. has been using these economic political sanctions left and right. Today they have sanctions against Russia, sanctions against Iran.
The latest is Venezuela.
Against Venezuela, against
Cuba.
Cuba, against North Korea. And they're threatening to increase all these sanctions to these countries. But the effectivity of these sanctions have been going down, as you have been explaining to me. Yeah. Well, let's highlight this with some of these news from the first one, the News Tribune. And it's an Associated Press interview. Russian economy boss, sanctions no longer bite. This is a statement from the Maxim Oryshkin, who told the Associated Press that the Russian economy is on track to grow at least 2% this year, a first after 2014 when the economy sank into recession driven by sinking oil prices and sanctions over the Kremlin's actions in Ukraine. Yeah? Mm-hmm. So people or countries are able to cope with these new developments, with the rise of China, the rise of BRICS, and so on.
You know, the theory of economic sanction is only possible if you control, say, 70% of the global trading, like what happened sometime in early 60s, 50s, and even in the 40s, late 40s, right after the war. Because the United States practically controlled the global economy. Mm. There was no World Bank, or there was no IMF, so to speak. Mm. So they controlled everything. But the United States barely controls 20%.
Today,
of the economy. How can you do that? Mm. So you impose trade sanctions, somebody will offer, what product are you prohibited from acquiring from the United States? We will offer it to you at a much cheaper price. Mm. Where will you go?
And when the U.S. with the European Union imposed sanctions on Russia, Russia started buying their fruits from Chile, from Asia, from other parts
Latin
of the world.
Latin American countries benefited from the trade sanctions, especially agriculture.
And even the Russian economy internally benefited because they started developing their agriculture.
When they tried to blockade the oil, gas oil pipeline from Russia to Western Europe, China benefited from that.
That's right.
What happened now?
And then the very big factor is China.
Yes.
Because China...
They concluded an agreement.
Could buy the oil of Russia, the gas of Russia, could provide the other goods that Russia needed, and the BRICS countries
in
too.
In fact, China can buy all the oil in Russia, but China did not do that so that Western Europe could also have their share.
Okay. And again, USA Today itself came out with a report entitled, Here's Why North Korea Sanctions Won't Work. And this is from USA Today itself. They give out the reasons why, even for North Korea, it's not going to work. And finally, on the other country that the U.S. has imposed sanctions on and is threatening to increase, on Iran. This is from the Cato Institute itself, this American think tank. And what does it say? Its headline goes like this, on the failure of Iranian sanctions. So it goes into this lengthy analysis, the graphs and charts and so on, But the point is, Iran is not bending to the U.S. sanctions. And of course, the major factor here is the principle behind BRICS, the alliance of the other countries, and the help they give to each other.
One thing unusual about the BRICS is that it is not in a hurry to admit new members.
Mm-hmm.
But definitely, many states have already manifested their intention to join. But if should it happen, what will happen to the World Bank? What will happen to the IMF? What will happen to the ADB? It's a big problem for them.
Well, I think China and the BRICS and these new alignments led by China and Russia, but in the economic and financial terms, it's China, has made it clear that these new banks, AIIB, New Development Bank, will not aim to compete directly, although in principle or in practice, it is an alternative already. You know? And they have invited, in fact, to AIIB, the participation of ADB, I think, and even World Bank. China's approach has been to always be win-win, as you also explained. The BRICS itself is based on the principle of win-win. Nobody should lose.
I guess the idea there is to invite the World Bank, the IMF, to join the BRICS because they have no choice. It's like an offer, you know. If somebody's selling this at 100 pesos and the other party selling it at 98, then definitely you will go to 95, 98. It will happen to you.
Okay. So I think clearly BRICS represents a shift, a power shift. And this article from the London School of Economics and Political Science says it all. Power shift, the decline of the West, the rise of the BRICS and world order in a new Asian century. And that is why we have this program of ours, Journeys, Chronicles of Our Asian Century.
Correct.
And we're trying to educate our Filipino audience and those in the international audience that follow us to now adjust their paradigms to this Asian century.
The old cobwebs we should shed off.
Shed off all the cobwebs from the U.S. Pax Americana.
We cannot rely forever on the United States. Financially, it's going down.
Okay. And I think the message about BRICS' final intention is expressed by President Xi Jinping of China. The headline, BRICS Committed to Global Peace, this is from the Economic Times. And I will read part of it. Chinese President Xi Jinping, on the eve of his meeting with Prime Minister Narendra Modi, attempted to send positive signals when he said, BRICS countries should uphold global peace and stability based on a vision of common, comprehensive, cooperative, and sustainable security. We quote, "We BRICS countries are committed to upholding global peace and contributing to the international security order," unquote. These are the words of President Xi Jinping himself. So with that, we approach our concluding part in this discussion. So what about the Philippines, Mr. Radkapunan? So far there has been no, the President Duterte attended the conference on the last May, was it last May? On the AIIB and this.
The creation of the AIIB, yes.
One Belt, One Road, I'm sorry, One Belt, One Road. But there is very little discussion so far in our foreign affairs, Secretary Cayetano or President Duterte, about BRICS. What do you think the Philippines should be doing?
The Philippines should understand that, we should understand that we can no longer rely on the United States. Remember that right after the Second World War, the United States launched an economic renewal system, we call it the Marshall Plan. I think the U.S. then poured in something like $20 billion to revive the economies of Western Europe.
Western Europe, basically. Yeah.
But it excluded the Philippines. Mm. The Philippines is an ally. Now, there is no way the United States can relaunch another Marshall Plan because it is saddled with economic debt. Ang laki ng utang ng America, something like 19 trillion.
Mm.
Ang laki-laki niyan. How can you imagine that?
Ang laki-laki niyan for our international audiences.
Yes.
That's a huge debt.
No? That's a huge debt. Cannot do that. So, the best thing for countries like the Philippines is to shift their attention to other financial institutions willing to offer them a bigger, a good bargain for their projects, something like that, like the BRICS and the EIIB. In fact, there is unusual about the EIIB. Even Western Europe joined the EIIB, like England. England is now a member. I don't know how the United States government reacted to that.
Well, they sent a delegation to the One Belt, One Road summit.
So, the United States should think twice. The posturing of its own allies. They are now shifting towards the East. I don't understand. And we Filipinos, we maintain our loyalty to the United States, but the United States has not offered us anything since our independence.
Don't you think that there is already a very huge change in the Filipino attitude to the U.S. and to China? Although this is not much talked about, but there is a silent shift already to more positive, and maybe at this point it's already balanced between
precisely
the positive feelings for the U.S. and for China.
You know, many Filipinos are no longer antagonistic to China, unlike in the early side, like something like even in the 80s.
Mm-hmm.
They are no longer, Filipinos are no longer antagonistic to China, and the Chinese are no longer antagonistic to the Filipinos. The Chinese no longer look at us as American stooges.
Yeah. And not only the Chinese, but ASEAN countries no longer see us as the American
puppet.
And so I think this spirit, of course, is shared by our colleagues in China that we featured in our section on people and places. Ms. Carol Ong, who is an entrepreneur in China, a Filipina entrepreneur in China. Then we now have this Chinatown TV tie-up with Chinese networks for news in the Philippines. And of course, our initiative here on Global News Network, with our friends who have supported us in the past, this program of ours to project this new vision for the 21st century, our Asian century, especially the Philippine-China partnership for peace and prosperity. And one final point is that the Philippines, with the present policy of President Duterte, foreign policy, has become a pivot point for global peace. This is the same message from the BRICS summit. But we have our last minute. Please give us some words of wisdom, finally.
I think it's the only word that I can say is that we have to re-examine our position, especially our economic position vis-a-vis with the United States. We can earn more by shifting our attention to the East, to China. China is not asking us to change our political loyalty. It's simply asking us to help them in the development of Asia. And we should be proud that we are part of that development. In fact, many Americans have been coming to the Philippines, have noticed that development in the Philippines is faster than in the United States. So many buildings. And I told him, the development in the Philippines is something that is
a spillover
of the wealth that is created in Asia, in China particularly, spillover. So we owe it to Asia. We owe nothing against the Americans while we are developing. Not because of them, not because of their economies. It is because we sought to identify ourselves with China and with Asia. Not only with China, with Asia as a whole.
And hopefully, in the times to come, more discussion and maybe more relations with BRICS as an economic alliance.
Yes.
With that, we thank you very much. It was a very enlightening discussion. And so, aside from being an Asian century, it's going to be a BRICS century too.
BRICS century.
Maraming salamat and have a good weekend.